Hachette Audio presents Snake Oil, The Art of Healing and Truth-Telling, written and read by Becca Stevens.
Kudzu Madonna. A kudzu Madonna on the side of a highway calls to searching pilgrims in need of a sign. Draped in the abundance of earth, she is a vision holding out her healing hand. Her forgiving nature is our first healer, and she dispenses her gifts like grace. Her flowers, trees, and hidden treasures are offerings from her sacred heart. There are mysteries in the weeds that make the world a mystical place. There is truth in the grass and clover that covers the whole earth with a healing balm. Introduction. A snake oil salesman. It's kind of like selling snake oils. The words slipped out of my mouth before I could take them back. Did I really just say that out loud? Being a luncheon speaker is never easy. You're competing with grumbling bellies, clanking forks, and drifting eyes, daydreaming about sneaking out early. This noontime gathering for a group of booksellers in Chicago was no exception. I was sharing the story behind Thistle Farms, a not-for-profit women's social enterprise based in Nashville, Tennessee that employs almost 4 dozen women. The organization began in 2001 as a program of Magdalene, residential communities that stand in solidarity with women who have survived lives of trafficking, addiction, and prostitution. I explained that for the past 12 years, we've made all-natural bath and body care products that we sell with the tagline, "Love Heals." While describing one of the products to the audience, I blurted out, "We basically take the ingredients used in your salad dressing, mix them into a body balm, say a prayer over the blend, and sell the concoction as a healing salve. It's kind of like selling snake oils." In front of 500 strangers, I compared myself to a snake oil salesman. The words slipped out, and I quickly moved on with the speech. And I'm not sure if anyone paid much attention between finishing the salad and waiting on the entree. But those accidental words meant something to me. Sometimes a passing thought seems to come from nowhere, but upon reflection provides a spark of insight on an idea that has been germinating for years. I knew I wasn't the stereotypical portrait of a snake oil salesman selling mixtures out of a dilapidated cart at a state fair. I'm more of a modern, social justice-driven version. I select time-tested homemade concoctions and tonics, mix them into an enterprise to help women, and market them as central to healing work that incorporates the body, mind, and spirit. Reflecting on the term snake oil salesman later that afternoon, I realized that though I'd considered the term repulsive for many years, the phrase actually suited me. For thousands of years, healers have handed down the ability to use oils properly. The name derives from the traveling shows out west in the 19th century and is rooted in the Native American traditions that use the oil from rattlesnakes as powerful medicine to help with rheumatism, arthritis, and other muscle and joint aches. Shamans shared recipes for balms and liniments from rattlesnake oils with early settlers of the American West. Salesmen then got the idea to market the oils from Native Americans and started making all kinds of claims. Thus began the journey of the snake oil salesmen who traveled throughout the West, peddling their wares and medicine shows and claiming healing for everything imaginable. How the oils got such a bad name doesn't lie in the oils themselves. The problem began when people exaggerated the oils' powers and made them into tools to deceive gullible people. As time went on, these snake oils contained less and less oil from snakes, and more homeopathic tonics filled with ingredients like red pepper and camphor mixed with alcohol, the latter having more to do with the concoction's soothing effects than the former. Although most of the homeopathic and essential oils necessary for healing were abandoned, these concoctions were still known as snake oil. The term is now used to refer to a worthless remedy, and a snake oil salesman is one more concerned with making a profit than helping people. I knew I needed to reclaim the title in a more positive light. After all, I had all the tools I needed to sell the promise of healing. I had a heart full of gratitude, a fair amount of brokenness, a healthy dose of skepticism, a hankering for entrepreneurship, and a big desire to help the underdog. All of those ingredients, mixed with being a priest and an advocate for women on the streets, created a recipe for changing lives. Instead of laughing the experience off, I want to embrace the moment and see where reclaiming the term snake oil salesman would lead me in the next few years of work. The comment I made was not meant to devalue the products or the healing abilities, but instead it was intended to offer freedom. The art of healing is a huge gift, the central sacrament of a community of faith can offer. Yet it is also one of the most abused aspects of the church. At Thistle Farms, we create aromatic and distilled healing oils derived from plants, which in turn we use in our bath and body care products for their therapeutic qualities, as they have been for thousands of years. The oils are the first medicine in history, and the qualities within the oils have potent healing properties that, combined with love and prayers, are a source of healing. Their antiviral, antibacterial, antifungal, and anti-infectious abilities make them valuable tools in the healing process. Thistle Farms products have become a means of selling hope and a cause. The products provide healing on many levels, both for those who create them and for those who use them. The products intersect naturally with snake oils because they're made from all natural ingredients, sold with the intent to heal, and they carry a larger hope with each purchase. Our products have evolved into a line that claims to heal skin, soothe stress, bring women into homes and off the streets, and heal world-weary spirits. The essential oils, including cinnamon and lavender, from which many of the products are derived, provide healing, yet their restorative abilities go beyond their chemical makeup. I find it ironic that I began my career by wanting to be a pastor, separated from the business of the world, and my desire for justice led me to make concoctions that Thistle Farms sells on an open market. Learning about oils has been like stepping into an age-old truth and feeling like you are discovering something new. I've never held much stock in those who claim to be faith healers, but I love that I've become part of a faith community that is dedicated to helping people heal both physically and emotionally. I find now that I have more in common with backwoods healers than suburban pastors. We can all claim to be healers on the journey. That's true for me and for all the women I work with. Some of the richest lessons on healing I've learned have come from working side by side making oils with women who have been brutalized in their bodies, have long arrest records, and could use some good old oil themselves. The women I began helping 15 years ago have been the biggest source of my own healing. One woman is Sarah, who at the age of 13 was sold in Atlanta to an organized group of men who made money selling images on the internet and servicing men who came to Atlanta for conventions. Now, as the mother of twins, she works hard to manage her health and recovery. The truth she teaches is that healing is not magic. We have to be willing to banish all judgment and love each other in order to heal well. She continues to struggle with post-traumatic stress that haunts those raped as children and then left to figure out how to survive on their own. Also, women like Penny, the director of the Healing Oils Division, who was raised in a bar and ended up living under a bridge for 10 years. Her prayers for years was simply not to wake up beaten or raped. She says the biggest healing experience for her has been the journey to learn to love herself. These are only two of the hundreds of women I have worked with, and they are powerful teachers that the journey of healing is not a fairy tale, but a long story of transformation that inspires us all to keep seeking healing. Sometimes even in the most unexpected moments and places, scores of other women are hoping to find the path of healing. More than 100 women are on waiting list to come into one of the community homes at Magdalene. From this vantage point, I am filled with gratitude for all the side roads that led me to the fringes of religious life. These side roads have led me deep into the wilderness, which is where we can learn some of the sweetest lessons about healing in life. Those trails have given me some pretty clear ideas about the role of truth-telling and faith healing, and the role of economics in a ministry that concerns itself with loving others. Those off-the-beaten-path experiences have given me a bird's-eye view into some of the joys of the healing process and the miracles that unfold on a daily basis in people's lives. And they've led me to take off my blinders to the injustice inherent in our systems and witness some heartbreaking stories. Today, I believe less of the dogma of institutional religion. What I still believe more deeply. This journey continues to expand my sense of the undeniable healing power created by the work of love. All of this has led me to share in the following pages what I found to be true. I've included some history of healing oils in the community that makes them, and some recipes so you can make them yourself. I've tried to create a space between snake oils and healing oils, although some overlap is necessary. This is my own blend.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.